Hi, welcome everyone. Welcome to the second day of CppCon. I hope everyone is enjoying themselves. I'm Victor, and we're gonna spend about an hour talking about 2020, the year of sanitizers. Last year, I had this slide up, and we were in a new venue in Aurora, Colorado. And I was asking, how is everyone enjoying the new venue and the same conference in a much bigger place? Today, I have to put up an updated slide. We have a new venue, but we're going to have the same great conference. A lot of people are here. I hope everybody already has a favorite table, remote table. And I'm wishing you all a very nice CppCon week. We're starting day two. Yesterday was already packed with news and really, really cool stuff. So enjoy CppCon. Due to the nature of the delivery medium and the streaming delays that incur, I prefer to take questions at the end. Make sure to write them in Remo and maybe upvote other people's questions. And I'll be available to answer questions at the end. But already some of the Visual C++ team is in Remo. And we also created a special interest channel for Visual Studio on the CppCon Slack. And I encourage you, if you have questions, come forward and ask them there or in Remo. So let's get started. The topic of today is Year of Sanitizers. And it's a story in three parts. We're going to start talking about static analysis a little bit and the importance of tooling in general. And then the larger part of the presentation will be about dynamic analysis and some warm, fuzzy feelings at the end. We'll see how that goes. Humans have always depended on tools to make their jobs easier. And as programmers, we daily depend on tools, for better or worse, on editors and linters and formatters and in auto refactoring tools, build systems, and so forth. We have productivity tools on the left side here and correctness or quality-oriented tools on the right. And we need all these tools. We need this ecosystem of tools, and we need complementary tools. And sometimes we need several tools that do the same job to make sure we have proper coverage and we check all the boxes and we get the benefits from each of them. And we're going to see some tools today. Why do I care about this? Because I became addicted to smart C++ tools. And my team and I have been wrangling using Clang-tidy for more than 3 years now. And we've been able to do awesome code transformations in a fairly old code base. And we're leveraging even more tools as we go along. And we have plans to integrate more tooling into our workflow. And this is the project I've been working on for 15 years now, Advanced Installer, and we've actually built some tooling to help us with transformations and Clang-tidy. Let's start with static analysis. We'll go over this part a little bit quicker because it's not the main focus of the presentation, but I want to do an overview of the static analysis tools available and what can you do to use them in or integrate them into your workflows. I'll start by highlighting the C++ core guidelines checker, and I'm pointing you here towards a few resources to read about. By the way, my slides are full of links and references that you can follow along as soon as you get the slide decks, and you can investigate and read at your own pace. So feel free to browse the slide deck when you get them. And recently, in Visual Studio 16.7, we have even newer safety rules in CPP Core Check. So I do encourage you to check them out. There are tons of checks built in into Visual Studio. and I've enumerated just some of them here. I want to point you to the three main static analysis tools that come with Visual Studio. You have a heavyweight code analysis tool that has a bunch of built-in checks. Then you have the Visual Studio linters, which is a much lighter set of checkers and linters. And then you have your LLVM Clang-tidy that is integrated into Visual Studio. Clang-tidy, I'm going to focus on Clang-tidy a bit, has hundreds of checks built in, and you can extend it with your own. I'm going to highlight a few of the checks that my team found very useful in our workflow. Tools that do automatic refactorings at scale, tools that do code modernization and checks. And for a minute or so, I'm going to focus a bit on a few checks around safety. By the way, if you have a nifty plugin for Visual Studio, you can easily toggle and see inline help for each of these checks. We have an interesting check, a bug-prone dangling handle in Clang-tidy, that is meant to detect dangling references in value handle types like string view. And people have started using string view freely now that's available in code bases. But it's very easy to construct a dangling string view from a temporary string. And this checks helps you a lot. And I'm sure by now you've probably heard of the lifetime profile checker. And its purpose is actually to make sure that you prevent common dangling that can occur from constructing a string view from a string or a span from a vector or an array. And dangling is very easily can very easily occur. So this check can help you. For a while now, we've had an experimental flag, W lifetime in Clang, that helps with this and can pinpoint misuses of string view with a temporary here. But more recently in Clang 10, we actually have a built-in check that is diagnosed by default, dangling GSL, and it warns about the very same scenario, pointing out the object that is bound to the string view is actually a temporary and it will be destroyed at the end of the expression here. If you want to learn more about the lifetime profile and how it was implemented and the rationale and the gotchas and what works, what doesn't, I encourage you to watch this talk by Gabor and Matthias. Clang-tidy checks are organized in modules and can be integrated into Clang-tidy. You can write your own. It's almost like a plugin model. And you can write your own matchers and your own fixits and transforms or checkers. And it's easy to build a custom check for your code base, aside from the built-in ones. And you can easily integrate them into your workflow. But the main takeaway here would be to actually run them regularly. It's not enough to run them once. You have to make a shift to make this a part of your workflow, a part of your routine to run your checks, be it the built-in ones or your custom checks that you've built. It's important to run them regularly to actually catch problems early. If you want to explore further and understand how to build refactoring tools, how to build matchers for the AST, I do recommend this excellent talk by Stephen Kelly and this talk by Fred Dingo, Clang-based refactoring. And I'm going to plug here one of my old talks about the same subject. And coming back to Visual Studio and the tooling we have available, Visual Studio, starting from 16.2, actually has Clang and LLVM support built in, both for MS Build and CMake projects. And it actually ships with Clang and the Clang CL driver, if you prefer to use that one. I prefer the Clang++ driver. So you can install it. 16.2, the first version that actually shipped was with LLVM 8. More recently, 16.7 has Clang-10. You can choose LLVM as a platform toolset for your project and actually compile your project with LLVM using the Clang-CL driver. And you can run Clang-tidy code analysis starting with Visual Studio 16.4. You can enable it from the project property sheets in the code analysis section, enable Clang-tidy. And you'll see reports from Clang-tidy in the familiar environment of the Visual Studio IDE in the error list. And you can navigate and see the warnings and fix them appropriately. So it's a familiar experience. Clang analysis also runs in automatically in the background. And you will see these surface as squiggles in the code and as tooltips or code lenses. And you can actually, as you write code and maybe think about something else about what you're trying to build there, these squiggles will remind you, hey, here you did a bubble. And it will even suggest fixes for you sometimes. If you're not able to upgrade to the latest versions of Visual Studio 2019, that means 16.4 or newer, there's no problem. You can use plugins such as Clang Power Tools and basically get the same functionality as an add-on. You can leverage Clang-tidy, compilation, format, checks, query. And now we're getting towards the main focus of this presentation. Again, coming back to tools that we use and trying to contrast what can we get out of static analysis tools such as Clang-tidy or the code analysis built into Visual Studio versus what can we gain from runtime analysis. Well, with static analysis, the checks are basically run offline outside of the normal compilation cycle. So they can take longer to process source code. That's why they can do deeper analysis and figure out stuff about your code, something that's not affordable at compile time, at regular compile time. They're intimately linked to the use programming language. They have to know about the language constructs and types and idioms, even. They can detect a lot of semantic issues because they know the language that they're supposed to work on. But they can yield a lot of false positives. And sometimes, I've done that. You can go on a wild goose chase investigating some weird corner case, and it turns out to be actually a false detection. They're usually pretty poor at whole program analysis, and they have trouble following connections in different translation units. They're almost helpless around virtual functions. Very often, it's very difficult to devirtualize calls and figure out what exactly it's called. They have weak analysis ability around global pointers, and the most pressing problem, I think, pointer aliasing makes it very hard to prove things. And alias analysis is a very, very hard problem. And you have basically a vicious cycle between inferring or type propagation and the alias analysis, which they seem to be depending one on the other, on the other. On the other side, dynamic analysis is sometimes intrusive. You need to compile the program in a special mode. Not all tools require that. There are some tools that do black box instrumentation. You do incur runtime overhead. You have a performance impact depending on a tool up from 2x up to 10x performance impact. You do see extra memory usage for memory-related tools and instrumentation of 2x or more. Sometimes it's difficult to map reports into your source code because of optimized builds and improperly aligned symbol information and line numbers and due to inline functions and intrinsics and so on. Some tools require you to recompile the whole program in an instrumented mode. For example, like the memory sanitizer. And you must integrate runtime analysis with your test units because what you don't test, you don't see. So runtime analysis means you actually have to run your program and take it through its paces or possible scenarios and make sure you have good coverage for your test units or for the scenarios you are actually planning to investigate. And the biggest impact when combined is when you're combining it with fuzzing, of course. But the killer feature of dynamic analysis is zero false positives, or so it should be advertised. And let's get into this. Let's talk about runtime analysis. I'll start with a short aside. I was surprised not many people actually know about control flow guard. I had a discussion yesterday after the Visual Studio presentation about the control flow guard, and some people were actually surprised. And it's a technology to enforce control flow integrity. It's supported at the operating system level in 8.1 and Windows 10. And it comes as a complementary mitigation with ASLR and data execution prevention. The interesting bit is, and this is something I recently found out myself, is that control flow guard is now supporting in LLVM 10. And it actually has support for C++ and Rust as well. So Microsoft has contributed this to the LLVM codebase. You can read up more on this at that link that I provided at the bottom. So just in case you didn't know. Okay, let's get back to sanitizers, the main focus of our presentation today. We have a bunch of them. We have an address sanitizer, a leak sanitizer, thread sanitizer, memory sanitizer, undefined behavior sanitizer, and very recently, I actually found out about a poll that Jens actually did around how people use a sanitizer or if they use it, use them at all. So I was a bit surprised about the results in this poll. And the thread sanitizers actually has fewer numbers than it should be because it was later on added to the poll. But my main concern was actually a lot of people don't use sanitizers at all. So I was thinking maybe this is related to the fact that they were building applications exclusively for Windows. Because if you have a cross-platform application, you can easily use sanitizers on your Linux builds or macOS builds. But if you have a non-cross-platform application that is Windows only, maybe that would be a showstopper for you in using sanitizers. I hope that that was the only showstopper, and now you can leverage the power of these tools. The main problem is common vulnerabilities. And it seems like even in 2019, 2020, CVEs actually are, and memory safety issues continue to dominate vulnerabilities exposed. And basically, there are two parts of this thing. And we're going to focus on address sanitizers for this talk, because it would be impossible to talk about all the sanitizers. And my main focus here is actually address sanitizers as it became available on Windows 2. So you have two sides of this. Address sanitizer is important for basic program correctness to make sure your program runs under intended behavior and it doesn't crash when given unexpected input. And about possible vulnerabilities that others can exploit in your application because of this. And it has become the de facto standard for detecting memory issues. It detects things like use after free, dangling pointers, heap buffer overflow, stack buffer overflow, global overflow, and others. It was started in LLVM by a team at Google and quickly took off as the de facto industry standard for runtime program analysis. It has very good documentation, but it's not properly spec'd as in terms of the runtime. So it takes a lot of work to actually port it to a different platform. We have address sanitizer in LLVM since 3.1 and soon after in GCC, starting with 4.8. But we got this on Windows in MSVC as late as 2019, late 2019. And there's a reason for that. And I'm trying to explain some of the problems in bringing this to Windows. So we have it. Starting with Visual Studio 16.4, we do have address sanitizer. And we got a sneak peek of what's going to come in this regard in Visual Studio at last year's CppCon, when Jim Bradigan did a fantastic demo of this technology. It was like a sneak peek, only partial stuff was available at the time. And starting with 16.4, you get this as an optional feature. It's still experimental. And the tech preview that was launched late last year was actually just a sneak peek and only able to instrument 32-bit applications in release mode. It was meant as a technology preview. And in the meantime, a lot of work has gone into it, and now it's ready for you to test it. As of August this year, with 16.7, we have ability to instrument 64-bit applications, both in release and debug mode. And Visual Studio has support for all debug runtimes, be that you statically link or dynamically link. And so basically now, starting with 16.7, it's still in experimental mode, but you have the ability to play around with the technology and see what works, what doesn't work for your projects. And I encourage you to actually report bugs. I did. But very fresh news from yesterday, actually. We have Preview 3 from Visual Studio 16.8. And this turns out to be a huge release. 16.8 is going to be a huge release for Visual Studio. And it has a lot of stuff to play around with, including lots of new stuff in Address Sanitizer. I'm going to talk about a few of the new stuff. So as I said, it's still experimental. Play around with it. Report bugs, ask for help, see what works and doesn't work for your project, and basically try to use it and see what you can uncover. As I said, bringing this technology to Windows is actually a big challenge. And the main problem is that the surface area of the Microsoft platform is enormous. You have a lot of non-standard C++ that the compiler needs to be able to compile and that the ASan runtime needs to work with. You have structured exception handling and access violation traps and filters. We actually have a lot of these in our application, and we've had to deal with the issues around asynchronous exceptions. You have vast amount of legacy code, really, really, really old code. Even within Microsoft itself, they have a ton of code that they need to compile and make sure they are able to interact with the ASan runtime. You have COM, which is still a big deal. You have managed C++. Yeah, that was a thing. And you have to make sure the ASan runtime interrupts properly with managed code, like .NET, because you can have mixed projects. I want to say a big thank you to the Microsoft team who is tirelessly working on this. Like I said, some of them are available in remote to answer your questions, even live or afterwards. Or you can post your questions in the SIG Visual Studio CppCon Slack channel. I do encourage you to reach out and ask questions if you have. So 2020, I think, really is the year of sanitizer in terms of we now have a complete availability for at least for the address sanitizer and some parts from other sanitizers. So we truly have no excuse now to actually make sure that our applications are properly checked and properly validated. Everyone will continue to invest heavily in this area of sanitizers, because they're so effective at finding correctness issues. And Microsoft has contributed back to the LLVM, all the work they've done to make the ASan runtime work on Windows. And everyone is basically pulling together to improve these tools. As workflows and supported scenarios, in Visual Studio have support for MS Build and CMake type projects, both for Windows and Linux targeting. And you also have debugger integration for MSVC and Clang. Like a sneak peek at how the experience might look, you're going to have a pop-up window that will report issues right there in the IDE. That's the IDE exception helper window that is going to be displayed when an error is incurred during the instrumented run of the program. And you can see the full logging information in the output window to investigate further. This is how it would look like in the output window. I want to take an aside here and actually feature a very cool tool or addition to Visual Studio that I very much find very useful, and that is the snapshot file. You can basically open a snapshot, a mini dump file, a snapshot of a Windows process that includes the virtual memory and the metadata associated with it. And you can open it in Visual Studio, and it will point you to the location where the error occurred. And I think it's a game changer. I think this technology will actually allow you to very easily report bugs, and you can even start interactive sessions via live share with your colleagues to actually debug and investigate issues this way. So I do encourage you to try out snapshot files. And ASan heavily leans on this technology, relies on snapshot files to make the experience smoother in the IDE. No need to dig up in the output raw output of the ASan runtime. So basically, you have the output of the ASan runtime report is parsed and surfaced within the IDE as actionable items to start drilling into code and investigating the issues where the error occurred. So it's an integrated experience. How does it work? I'm going to spend a little bit of time explaining how the ASan runtime works, because it was interesting for me to find out, and I found it very instructive. And also, it seems like for many people, it seems like magic. So I'm going to try to demystify it a little bit. So in short, ASan is just like malware, but it's used for good. Let's say we have an instrumented application here on the left that has struck a problem. That was a funny surprise. You actually get Windows Defender actually complains about this as if it was malware. So you have two parts of the address sanitizer. You have the compiler that does the instrumentation of the code, the stack layout, and calls into the runtime when it needs, and also provides metadata in the object file for the runtime. And on the other side, you have the sanitizer runtime that acts like a malware. It basically hooks and hooks APIs like malloc, free, memset, and many others, and basically has its own implementations to instrument these calls and track memory usage in your application. It provides error analysis and very detailed reporting, and it does not require a complete recompile. And that's great for interop. So you can basically, with some caveats, interop between modules that are instrumented with ASan and stuff that's not compiled with ASan on. And the best part, you have zero false positives. A detailed report might look like this. It starts with a backtrace. It tells you that you have a heap buffer overflow here, and it gives you more information about what happened in that particular memory region. And it gives you like a memory map that it's very hard to understand at first, and basically pinpoints where the fault was detected. You have a little legend at the end, and it actually tries to explain basically if you have a zero there, then you have its addressable memory. And if you have a negative number there, in the shadow byte. I'm going to talk about that. Basically, it's an issue marker. How it works? The runtime actually does shadow mapping. It maps your process memory into some auxiliary lookup memory. And it does this by shadowing or mirroring your allocations and putting stuff that it's called red zones around your memory allocations. So this stuff is called poisoned memory. So it's locations around your allocations that should be checked in case of overflows, for example. And basically, this is how it works. A very simplified bird's eye view of the code generation behind it. It's let's say you have a store at a pointer location, and you have an inserted code by the runtime that checks if that location in the shadow byte is good or bad. And if it's bad, it reports the error and makes the application crash. So it stops it from actually storing the value at the bad location. So if the shadow byte is poisoned, you don't have the store happening to prevent maybe a potential exploit there. And lookups into shadow memory need to be very, very fast. You don't want to have an enormous overhead for this functionality. You want one of the design goals of ASan was to be much, much faster than the tools that were previously available for this. And ASan maintains a lookup table where every 8 bytes of user memory are tracked by one shadow byte, so about 1/8 of address space for the shadow region. And the calculation is fairly simple to translate this location into shadow memory. Basically, you divide by 8 the user address, and you add some offset, and then you mark the shadow byte with some specific code indicating the problem that may arise when trying to access that poisoned location. A simplified function checking if a location is poisoned would be computing the address, basically dividing by 8, adding this offset, and checking for non-zero. So that offset is the location of the shadow region in memory, so where it starts. And this is the shadow byte that you have to check. So fairly simplified view, but more or less this is what happens. So let's suppose we have a write at P, and P is checked, and it happens to be a good location, so it's not poisoned. And in this case, the runtime lets the program execute further, and you have a store in P, food in this case. Let's say we have another store attempt with bad food, and now it's a location that is outside of our allocated memory, allocated objects. And we basically land in a red zone. We land in a shadow byte that is poisoned. And now the ASan runtime will detect this and print that report that I've shown earlier and actually crash the application so that the store doesn't happen. Fairly simple. The way it does this is that hooking malloc, for example, usually allocations are very dense in memory. This helps with caching and ensures locality. But the ASan allocator actually inserts gaps between allocated objects. So it does this because it wants to put red zones and mark these gaps as poisoned memory in the shadow memory. So this is how it does it. It marks each gap around the objects and the boundaries of the allocations with red zones. And when you have an attempt to write such a location, then you have the ASan runtime flare up and report the issue. Interesting, when the allocation happens, so if you see here, we have object allocations number 3. And when the object is deallocated, its corresponding shadow byte is poisoned. And this is intentional to delay the reuse of freed memory. And this prevents actually accessing deallocated stuff. So we can detect heap underflows, overflows, and use after free or double freeze, stuff like that. So very neat trick, sounds simple. I'm sure it's more complicated. The devil is in the details, as always. But it's easily to create a mental picture of what happens behind this and understand it's not actually magic. If we think about stacks, about the same thing happens there. Let's say we have a byte buffer here and some integer on the stack, and we want to access some location that it's not allowed, like the 13th location here. And again, when the function is entered, the stack is poisoned around the allocated stack variables. You have some left red zones. It's marked with a special marker. We have the mid stack red zones and the end marker for the stack allocations, which is called the right red zone. Doesn't matter. The naming is not important. Basically, when you try to actually access this buffer location, again, the ASan runtime injects this code into your program, and it checks that location to see if it's poisoned. And in this case, that location is marked as a red zone. And again, the ASan runtime would flare up and report the problem, and it will crash the application before attempting to actually write that zero in the 13th location in my byte buffer. Pretty simple, right? An interesting one is the container overflow. And this one has to come with some help of code annotations in the standard library. Right now, it's available on libc++ and libstandard C++. And basically, it can detect when you try to access locations that are outside, they are in the allocated memory for a vector, so they are within the capacity of the vector, but they are outside the bounds of the meaningful values in that vector, so beyond the end. And you can read more about this at the link that I provide there. And the idea behind it is very similar. The region filling up the capacity of the vector is poisoned, and it's marked as FC, container overflow. That's a marker for container overflow. And in this scenario, if we have this simple access pattern and we try to access the fourth location here via an indirection, we get a container overflow in ASan. I just want to point out, if we would try to do this using the vector subscript directly, many implementations of the library could detect that and actually report that. But as soon as you introduce pointer aliasing, it's much more difficult to track stuff like that. And I intentionally used here an indirection via P so that this scenario can be caught by the ASan, just by the ASan. This is a neat one. I recently found out about this one. Very, very nice one. And all this business has to be very, very fast. And indeed, the average slowdown for an instrumented program is around 2x. Might be higher for some intensive computational programs. But in general, this would be an accepted slowdown for an application. You can see more performance numbers at the link I provided there. I'm going to go over a few problems and gotchas. Some stuff you need to know about using this stuff in Visual Studio. I did most of my testing in 16.7, and the point release is after that. And I did a bunch of testing in the preview builds of 16.8. So your mileage might vary. Some of the stuff it's older that I and might be fixed very soon. Some of the stuff are still outstanding problems. And I'm going to report some of the mitigations and what you can do, if anything, about that. First of all, compiling and linking from the command line is a tedious thing. You have to be very careful to choose the appropriate ASan library to link against depending on your architecture and build mode, if you're linking dynamically or statically. So you have to be very careful and check the documentation and see that you link with the appropriate ASAN libraries. Otherwise, you're going to get incomprehensible stuff from the linker. So do check this blog post and see all the details there. I just highlighted just one example here. First thing that you're going to hit, probably, because the default template in Visual Studio for projects is using edit and continue for debug builds, at least. So first thing you're going to hit is that the address sanitizer is incompatible with edit and continue. We actually don't use this scenario in debug builds, but many developers actually love this feature. So you would have to disable this for the for your ASAN experiments, at least temporarily. A really significant issue, I would say, is mixing ASAN and non-ASAN modules. I alluded to this earlier. If you have scenarios like, for example, you're building a plugin or a DLL that is loaded by an application that you don't have source code of or you don't have control over, say you're building a plugin for a third-party application, then you might be in trouble because non-ASAN built executables cannot call load library on a DLL built with ASAN. So basically, you're a bit stuck here. So the reason is that ASAN tracks memory, like I showed earlier, and non-ASAN executable might have heap allocations that the ASAN runtime cannot track. And there are some limitations here. And the MSVC team said they're considering dealing with this issue in a later release. But as of today, this is a showstopper if you have this particular scenario. Another scenario that I actually ran into when doing tests on our project is that in debug builds, we actually use RTC and RTC1 runtime checks. And these are, again, incompatible with the ASAN runtime. And the fix is easy. You just have to temporarily disable these checks as you run your ASAN experiments. The weird part about it is that this is a relatively harmless warning that you get from the compiler. And you could easily ignore it. But if you actually use WX and you treat your warnings as errors, as you should, then this is a build blocker. So the fix is easy. You just have to disable these checks for the debug builds. On release builds, they're already off. There are some missing ASAN runtime PDBs from the Visual Studio installer. I'm sure these will be fixed immediately. Maybe they're already fixed in the latest preview of 16.8. You have VC ASAN-D and ASAN libraries. And again, if you're linking static libs against an EXE, you have a different set of PDBs that you need. So these seem to be missing from the installer, but this should be fixed readily. And by the way, these are not showstoppers. You can continue the build without these warnings. When building a static library linked into an EXE, you get other linker warnings around these hooked memory APIs like malloc and free. This should be harmless, but I think the experience can be improved here because people coming and trying this out might find this very disconcerting and be confused about these warnings. So I think this could be improved in terms of experience. It's not a showstopper by any means. I bet you didn't expect to see MFC featured at CppCon 2020, but here we are. A lot of MFC applications still out there. We don't have any, but many of you maybe have. And right now, if you link statically to the MFC library, you might get warnings around the new and delete allocators being overridden here. Again, these tie into the hooking mechanism of the ASAN runtime. And the workaround is fairly easy. You can use force multiple as a linker command line in the settings. Or you can temporarily set your MFC application to link to a shared MFC DLL, at least for testing under an ASAN. I think the force multiple workaround is easier. So keep this in mind. A frequently asked question that I get is, can ASan also detect memory leaks? Yeah, and it can detect some memory leaks, like, for example, if you don't have a virtual destructor, it can report a new and delete mismatch in terms of the allocated size. I do encourage you to explore further here. There are two very good articles by Augustin Popa here, dealing with all the details that I described here and many more other nitty-gritty details. So if you have the time and curiosity, I do encourage you to read upon them. And the closing part, right now we're gonna get very fuzzy. And I'm gonna tell you that the true power of sanitizers actually comes when you combine them with fuzzing. That is to automatically generate inputs for your program to actually make it crash and surface underlying issues that might be there hidden in the code. So if you don't have proper testing, fuzzing can really help a lot in combination with your test units. So basically, you have this workflow where you're actually fuzzing the program and compiling it with the ASan runtime, and you continually in a loop check every input that you can throw at the instrumented application and see if anything crashes, basically. And no talk in 2020 would be complete without mentioning cloud stuff. And I'm going to mention here the Microsoft Security Risk Detection Service. And this service will basically let you throw all this work of fuzzing and running instrumented applications under the fuzzer in Azure. And I basically stole this slide from Jim Radigan's presentation that I linked there. So if you want to learn more about this, basically you can spread the workload of running these instrumented applications across this cluster of worker machines in Azure, and they will aggregate the build results and push them towards an aggregation reporting service, and you can basically get reports into Visual Studio, and you can even get those snapshots files that I mentioned earlier and import them in Visual Studio and see where errors occurred. You can even connect remotely to the specific VM instance where the problem occurred and debug it there. Very neat stuff. I haven't had the chance to play with this and I am dying to. So this is how it would look like in the Azure portal. And you see the builds there happening, and you can access reports like I mentioned earlier. If you want to learn more about this, there's a very interesting session at the end of the week. I do encourage you to mark this in your schedules, introducing Microsoft's new open source fuzzing platform. This should be very, very interesting announcements. And I'm really looking forward to seeing this session. And if we want to learn more about Microsoft's One Fuzz effort and the platform that you can download from GitHub, it will be open source and you can run fuzzing in Azure. And I'm very, very excited to learn more about this and play around with it myself. So do check this session in your calendars for Friday. I have the link there. I look forward to see many, many, many days of bug fixing using this technology. I already started finding some stuff, and I'm sure we're going to find lots more as soon as we unleash the power of fuzzer and actually put our applications through the paces and uncovering latent bugs that lurk there. So I hope you're as excited as I am to leverage the power of ASan on Windows. And I'm really looking forward to your questions and maybe share your experiences in this regard. And looking forward to chat with you. And if you have questions, I'll be happy to answer if I can. Or you can catch me at one of the tables. I'll be around Vimo all day. So do find me. Let's see if we have any questions. Are there any cross-platform tools available for CppCon guidelines checks? Yes, Clang-tidy actually has CppCon guideline checks built in. So you can use Clang-tidy, and it is cross-platform. Let's see another question. Is it worth using more than one static analysis tool on the same code base? How many do you use on your projects? Yes, it's worth it. We actually use the built-in static analysis tools from Visual Studio in addition to Clang-tidy checks. So I alluded to this during the intro of my presentation. You actually uncover different stuff. So each tool has its strengths and weaknesses, and your best bet is actually running them all in terms of static analysis. And yes, you'll have lots of false positives there, but you'll be surprised that you'll uncover a lot of subtle bugs that in your code. So I actually advocate using both static analyzers, the one in Visual Studio, there are actually two there, and Clang-tidy. So use more, definitely. How does ASan compare to Valgrind? Well, I don't have much experience with Valgrind, but Valgrind itself actually instruments your whole applications. First of all, Valgrind is just for the Linux ecosystem. So there's a treasure trove of plugins and extensions for Valgrind, and it's a very mature, and there's a whole ecosystem around it, and you can use it on Linux. Basically, Valgrind, it instruments your application as a black box, more or less, and you don't get to recompile bits of the application in instrumented mode. So basically instruments your whole application, and it's much slower in terms of ASan, compared to ASan. So Valgrind is something like 10x performance hit versus ASan, which is like 2x, maybe 3x. What are some popular ASan tools we can use without Visual Studio? If you're talking on Windows, then it's tough. I would stick with Visual Studio. If you have a cross-platform project, you can use ASan with LLVM or GCC. So ASan is available both in GCC and LLVM if you have a cross-platform project. But if you're exclusively on Windows, using it outside Visual Studio, it's hard work. And basically, you have to use at least the build tools from Visual Studio and do the linkage, like I said, manually. And it can be done, but you have to use the build tools from Visual Studio. So basically the compiler and linker, which are free to use. So you can use them without using the IDE, Visual Studio IDE per se. So you can use the build tools, and you can link with the ASan runtime without using the IDE. It can be done, but you have to read the documentation carefully. Is there anything in ASan that makes it less likely for a buffer overflow to skip over the poisoned area into another valid memory area? Definitely. I cannot cover this in a presentation. The runtime is actually very smart about this. So it cannot be easily fooled like this to actually skip a poisoned region and land into some valid memory. The devil is in the details. So it's a rock solid mature technology. It has been under development for more than 8 years. So, and it's used at scale, by the way. It's used in very, very large applications in many companies. So it's a very mature technology. And it was basically brought on the Windows platform, and it brought all that experience and all that goodness on Windows. So it's a mature technology. It's not a recent addition that we just got in Visual Studio. It's a very mature technology, and I trust it 100%. Can other non-standard containers use container overflow memory marker? There was a plan to make it for DEC, and I think for DEC, I think, but I'm not sure if it was or not implemented at all. So right now, I for sure I can say just for vector, but it definitely can be implemented for continuous data structures. For node-based data structures, such as maps, it's much more difficult, but I don't know the details. Can we separate warnings from Clang checks versus other warnings? Yes, you can. They have a type, they have different codes, so you can filter them in the error window. So you can separate build errors or build warnings from Clang-tidy warnings and checks. You can do this both in Visual Studio directly and if you use Clang Power Tools. How can the Clang sanitizers compare to what the application verifier from Windows SDK offers? It's different. Application verifier basically has some rules that it checks, it basically checks compatibility issues that are known for different classes of applications on different targeted operating systems, and it has some shims in place to detect basically compat issues, and it can detect improper API usage and even stuff that is memory related, but it's not by all means a general purpose tool. So I've used the application verifier, but for totally different scenarios, not for memory safety or correctness issues. Is ASan incompatible with custom memory allocators? Oh boy. I don't have a straight answer there. My guess is it can work, but it can work with custom allocators, but you need to put in extra effort to actually make it work. I don't have any experience in this area, so sorry. Maybe somebody else attending the conference can. I'm actually curious about this one myself. Maybe somebody else knows about it and can give us some straight answers. Is support for other sanitizers coming? I don't know. maybe. Interesting, some parts of other address sanitizers are actually included in the ASan on Windows. For example, parts of UBSAN are actually included in Visual Studio. So other sanitizers might be coming, but so far, no announcements have been made. I would like to see them myself. Does instrumenting your build with ASan affect the build time? A bit, yeah. I've seen this, but it's not as bad as you think. So it affects build time, but not by much. I've actually used it tried it in fairly large projects, and it's okay. That's not the main problem. Problem is dealing with the bugs and making sure everything works, by the way, because your projects might be difficult to link with the ASan runtime. Is this also a Microsoft open source standard library? This has nothing to do with the STL. From my knowledge, the STL from MSVC has no annotations for stuff like vector container overflows or stuff like that. So basically all the code is in the MSVC compilers, because there are more compilers, and that part is not open sourced. So from my knowledge, maybe somebody else from Microsoft can give a better answer there. Does CMake have the ability to generate a VS project with ASan entirely set up? ASan can be activated for CMake projects in Visual Studio. You just have to add just one entry in the CMake list JSON file. It's fairly straightforward to activate. You don't actually have to convert your project from CMake to Visual Studio to make it work, because Visual Studio can actually work with CMake projects for years now. Okay, I guess we don't have any more questions. Thank you all for your time. I hope you find this session instructive and you enjoyed it. I do encourage you to ask around for questions in the Slack channel for Visual Studio, or maybe find us in Vimeo. I'll be more than glad to chat with you about this.